And of course, we love our From the Field sponsors. Today, we're sponsored by Betty and Richard Frangish. Thank you so much for sponsoring us today. And if you would like information on sponsoring one of our webinars, please contact Kate Fitzwilliams at that phone number or kate@savingcranes.org. We would love to have you sponsor. We're going to keep our From the Fields going as long as we have crane things to talk about. So today, it is my great pleasure to introduce my friend and colleague in cranes, Mike Forsberg, and he is going to talk to us today about his project, Cranes, Planes, and a Watershed. Take it away, Mike.
My presentation today is going to be a journey. I'm going to take you on a journey sort of behind the scenes of what it's like to be a photographer working with these birds and in their various landscapes up and down the North American continent. And you know, we all have a story to tell, and each one is important and each one is unique. And hopefully you can find some connection between my story and yours. So Cranes, Planes, and a Watershed is the title, which is sort of a riff off of the 1987 movie classic starring Steve Martin and John Candy, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. So we'll take it away here. I'm going to give you first a video collage of some things that I've shot in Nebraska, where most people think there's nothing out here except cornfields and flatness. So here we go. These are trumpeter swans on the Calamus River in the mighty Nebraska sandhills in winter. You all will know where this is. These are cranes coming to the roost on the Platte River in a blizzard in late February. I'm from the tower at Roe Sanctuary. And our wetlands with our beaver and otter. And in the Wildcat Hills of western Nebraska in the Panhandle, where they're reintroducing bighorn sheep to their historic range. Many of you know what these are, the prairie chickens in our tall grass prairies. And the federally endangered least tern. Watch for the chicks on the nest. And a wet meadow on the Platte with the white-tailed deer walking across at sunset. So that's a little bit about where I'm from. And when I was a kid growing up, I had no idea that any of that was out there. And it wasn't because my parents kept me in the basement and didn't let me go outside, so I was outside all the time. But when we went into the natural world, we drove 500 miles to the west, to the Rockies in Colorado. And that's where I learned to fall in love with nature. And that's me at about 8 years old, a hapless Miami Dolphin fan, and the big mountain behind in this photo is Long's Peak, which is one of the tallest peaks in the Front Range of the Colorado Rockies. And I told my dad that day, he said, when he took my picture, that I pointed with my stick and I said, "Daddy, I'm going to climb that mountain someday." And in college, I did. This is from the summit of Long's Peak. And I was up there with five of my very close friends. And as we were on the summit of the peak in late May, Everybody was turning around looking to the west at all those ragged, jagged peaks falling off in the distance. But I turned around and looked east, out over that flat, hazy horizon in the distance that I knew was my home on the plains. And for the very first time in my life, I thought that it was beautiful. So for the last several decades now, I have fallen in love with the place that is my home. And my gateway really into that in a deep way has been with cranes. You know, sandhill cranes, especially on the Platte River in Nebraska, that fall like autumn leaves against a prairie sunset. And as most of you know, it's the largest gathering of cranes anywhere in the world. And one of the most remarkable experiences one can ever have in nature, a spiritual experience. So my very first job as a photographer was working for a magazine called Nebraska Land Magazine, a state's conservation publication. And my editor gave me one of my first assignments as he said, Michael, I want you to go out and photograph cranes. And I said, everybody's done that, you know, a million times. And he said, yeah, but you haven't. And I'd like to see what you can bring back. But what I don't want you to bring back anything of is pictures of sunsets. I've seen a million of them. Show me something different. So scared to death I was going to lose my job before I even started, I went out and drove county roads and started looking for cranes in other places. This was the my office, and this is what I wore as my suit to go to work during the day. And I eventually found a farmer who had pasture land that was along the banks of the South Channel of the Platte, and he let me put a blind in place. Two blinds, one along the channel and then one up along a fence line. And this is what it looked like inside. And every day I would slide into these blinds before the first hour of light, and I would wait for cranes to show up in these pasture wetlands, these wet meadows that they would come and stay in the middle of the day, that really nobody up to that point had seen much of, what they do during the middle of the day. And I was in and out of these blinds on and off for a week and failed miserably every day until the very last day that I had before I needed to go home. I slid into this blind and the birds came. This is what I saw. They came so close to that blind that I could have picked up and tossed a stone underhanded and had it land right at their feet. I got to see them in these intimate moments where they were dancing with each other, unison calling, stretching like ballerinas, even drinking. They were so close that I could hear them drink. I could hear them eat, crunching the tiny little snails that they were pulling out of this wetland prairie. I even got to watch them bathe as the sun came out later in the day. It was one of the most remarkable experiences I've ever had in my life as a photographer, and I'll never, ever forget it as long as I live. And at that point, I was hooked. But the thing I also realized is that we tend to look at wildlife in a box. You know, we see them where they're at when they're in front of us, and we celebrate that presence. But a lot of times we don't think much about where they come from and where they go to and where else are they. How do they spend the rest of their lives? And I knew at least I was that way. I wanted to figure out what the majesty of these birds were. I wanted to get under their skin, and I wanted to go with them. So for the next 5 years, I traveled with these birds to create this book called On Ancient Wings, the Sandhill Cranes in North America, that was sponsored by the International Crane Foundation, and with a wonderful introduction written by George Archibald and Jim Harris. And I remember the early days when I was just getting started to go out and do this book. We had found the funding, and George and I sat at his dining room table in his house in Baraboo Hills, and we charted out the 13 places that I would end up going and spending that time. And it was, again, one of the most significant moments in my life. But one of the core things I wanted to do is I wanted to travel with these birds in the Central Flyway up and down the continent. So this gives you an idea of where these birds go from a study that was done by Gary Crapu years ago, where all those little red dots show these birds as they're transmitting their signals back to scientists. And I got to go to places like the Yukon-Kuskokwim River Delta on the edge of the Bering Sea, just south of the Arctic Circle, and got to work with researchers there to see these cranes on the nests when they're just as big as your fist, if you make a fist like the size of a tennis ball, and then grow, you know, in a period of you know, two and a half months to be the size of their parents almost, and then fly across these magnificent wild places, like across the Alaskan range in Denali in the middle of Alaska, and out across the Great Plains and down the ladder step of rivers and potholes to playas until they end up into the desert southwest and places like Bosque and Muleshoe and the Janos grasslands in northern Mexico. But I also got to see them in other places in the continent too, you know, completely different than what was in Alaska, you know, in the wilds. But you see them, you know, like they're walking home from school with kids in a suburban neighborhood in Orlando, Florida, or see them being used in research with ICF and other scientists up in Wisconsin when they were figuring out how to use these birds for science to help their endangered crane species better survive. And the thing that I learned through all of this 5 years was that cranes are great connectors. They connect habitats and peoples up and down the flyways in every place that they reside. The other thing that I learned about them is that they're great ambassadors. They're ambassadors for the habitats that they need. The wetlands and grasslands that at a glance, let's face it, are not that sexy. But if you get into them and linger, they're remarkable. And these cranes become poster children for the same habitats that we depend on too, as human beings, to thrive. Now, the most important pictures that were made during this project did not come from me. They came from my children, my wife Patty and I's children, Elsa and Emmy. And Emmy's there is on the left. I probably guess that that's a, a small baby crane. And then Elsa's on the right, you know, with the family of cranes. But that was the most important thing that happened to me during the making of this book, is that these two children of ours were born, the joys of our life. Elsa on the left, Emmy on the right. Well, when the kids came along, you know, your perspective changes. And as a photographer at that point, I had a choice to make of either trying to travel the world to photograph nature and to tell conservation stories, or try to do something closer to home. So that started this next project. I chose to be closer to home, and I wanted to discover my big backyard on the Great Plains, which was once one of the greatest ecosystems on the face of the earth. And here it is. You know, if you look at it, It's so large. It's a million square miles. It's if it was its own country, it would be the 10th largest in the world. And it is at, you know, at its size, it's roughly 23 million people in the Great Plains. Well, there's 23 million people in the Los Angeles basin alone. So we're pretty spread out here compared to other parts of the country. But it doesn't mean that we're not developed. And it doesn't mean that there aren't big conservation challenges. So what I wanted to do in this book is I wanted to pull the curtain back and show people that there is a lingering wild that's still left out there that's worth protecting. And I also wanted to take an honest look to see what sort of shape the system is in, so we can address those challenges. And photography is a really powerful tool to do that. So I got to travel down roads like this, 100,000 square miles of roads like this over the next 5 years or so, through the Nebraska sandhills like this. I spent a lot of time in blinds laying there like I did with cranes years earlier. But out of persistence and patience and a tremendous amount of good luck and a lot of failure, I was able to make pictures like this. A burrowing owl on Prairie Dog Town at sunset. prairie chickens at first light, western grebes in their amazing courtship dance in the Missouri Coteau in North Dakota. Out here in Nebraska, on these wetlands where the sky is our mountains. These amazing moments in the Flint Hills of Kansas and the remnant tall grass prairies. Migrations still exist, like pronghorn migration that spill out of Canada in the hundreds, sometimes thousands of animals, almost like the caribou migrations in the far north. And small little migrations, like these tiny little fish that are as colorful as fish in a coral reef, but they're only about as big as your pinky. And they live in headwater streams in the tallgrass prairies in Kansas. And some of our most endangered mammals on Earth, black-footed ferrets. And bobcats, tiny little bobcat on a prairie that's just 15 miles outside of Lincoln, Nebraska, where I live, in a prairie that was protected because a community saw the value in it so that it wouldn't become developed into a residential neighborhood. These are all things that happen every day here in the Great Plains, and it's, I think, one of the greatest untold stories left, even though we've heard the story many times, that oftentimes gets lost to history. And so with the Great Plains, for me, it was another personal chapter in my life. And during that time, Elsa and Emmy grew. So here they are on my buddy Dan O'Brien's ranch in western South Dakota with bison skulls. And here are Elsa and Emmy today. Elsa just graduated with a degree in fisheries and wildlife at the University of Nebraska, and right now is working on a national wildlife refuge in the Sandhills. Daughter Emmy is now at the University of Nebraska, Omaha, enrolled in the aviation program and wants to make her life as a pilot, putting her piloting skills to what she tells me as doing good work for the world. And when I look at these kids today, all grown up, the thing that I think about most about their lives moving forward is what sort of shape we're leaving this world in for them. What challenges are they going to have? And one of the biggest challenges I think that we're going to have that we have to address and we're addressing now, and the Crane Foundation is addressing now, is water. What about water? Not just how much water we have, but is that water good quality? Is it safe to drink? So let me take you back to the Platte River for a second, standing at Audubon's Rose Sanctuary in late September. And I was there walking this dry riverbed many years ago. And Bill Tadikin, the manager at the sanctuary, said, Michael, he said, the water is coming back to the river. Irrigation season is over. And I drove over the Minden Bridge this morning, and that tongue of water was coming. I think if you walked outside and grabbed your camera and walked up that river channel, you'd probably run into it. And I did. I hadn't gone more than a couple hundred yards, and I came around the corner right as the sun was setting, and here is this tongue of water slowly making its way down the channel, and it was one of the most powerful things that I have ever experienced. And it was as if somebody had turned on the hose underneath the sand, and the water was actually coming up from underneath first. And then that tongue of water would surge forward. And if you look really closely into that tongue of water, you could see these tiny little fish that were pushing on the surface tension, trying to move it, you know, downstream. And the birds were coming in and the deer were coming out. It was like this Disney moment. And I knew then that the next thing that I was going to try to do was to work on water. So this is that same exact location, but from 2,000 feet up in an airplane, looking west over the Platte River. And it begs the question, where does our water come from? Now, at this moment, I want all of you that are here to think about that question for you. And when you go turn on water at your tap, where does that water come from? Where does it start and what is its story? And what does it mean to live in a watershed today? You know, back in the late 1800s, John Wesley Powell actually proposed to Congress back in 1890 that we organize ourselves politically by watershed boundaries, because he knew state lines that we drew on a map, those straight lines that nature pays no attention to, probably were going to be difficult and they were going to be cumbersome. But what if we thought about the world organized and our lives organized by watersheds? Well, his idea rang true, but it wasn't politically expedient, and so it got shot down. But that idea still lingers today. This is a watershed. This is my home watershed in Nebraska, Colorado, and Wyoming. Here it is, the Platte Basin. So any of you that come to the Platte River and you watch cranes in the spring, this is where that water comes from. That's where, you know, it comes from this 90,000 square mile region that starts in the mountains and ends as it dumps into the Missouri on the north or the eastern shoulder of Nebraska. And in our watershed, we get it from three places. We get our water from that big bank account in the mountains of snowpack that turns into snowmelt. And we get it from the holy grail of the high plains. I like to call it the Ogallala Aquifer, the water underneath our feet, that vast underground reservoir of water that holds almost as much water as the Great Lake. And then we get it from our weather and climate, of course. Back on the Platte River at Rose Sanctuary, where many of you have been, this is what the water looked like in 2011 from a camera that we had placed on top of a tower. In 2011, the bathtub was full in the Great Plain, in the Platte watershed, and it was throughout the northern Great Plains. In 2012, from the exact same location, here's how it looked. In 2012, somebody shut the water off and we went into an extreme drought that lasted for almost 2 years. So we went from this having a wealth of water to this having little, if any, water at all. What if you could see the changes from this to that? What if you could document that over time? What if you could bring that old, boring physical geography textbook and bring it to life? Well, here's a time lapse of that same location from 2015, where we're watching that river change over time. That camera has been in place now for several years, and it's captured hundreds of thousands of images, taking pictures every hour of daylight, every day, to bring this river to life in a way that's never before been seen using the technology of time-lapse cameras. So I'm gonna let this play just a little longer, but what you see is you can see this thing breathe. So we started this project in 2011, and the we is myself on the right and my buddy Mike Farrell, who worked as a television producer and documentary filmmaker studying the Great Plains for 45 years out of Nebraska Educational Television. Mike and I's idea was to place cameras across the entire Platte Basin, time-lapse cameras, and each one of these dots is a different camera that represents a different chapter in the story of that water as it moves through our watershed. And each one is very different. So here's the highest one in the watershed. This is at a place called Lake Agnes, which is at over 11,000 feet in northern Colorado. The lowest one is where the Platte River dumps into the Missouri south of Omaha at the confluence. And now I'm showing you different scenes from different cameras that we have placed in the landscape, from high alpine to montane to the edge of development along Colorado's Front Range, to one of the first dams ever placed on the Platte River in Wyoming at Pathfinder, to the last dam placed on the Platte at Lake McConaughey and Lake Ogallala. Beautiful scenes in the sand hills of Nebraska. We have them on windmill stock tanks, on irrigation pivots in farm country, at Rose Sanctuary on one of the biggest roosts anywhere in the world, And down on the lower Platte, where it really broadens out before it reaches the Missouri. Here's what one of those cameras looks like. And you can see it gets put to good use and gets pretty beaten up out there over time. This is in the Sandhills of Nebraska. And this is a picture, a tiled picture of images of every noontime photograph that it made from December 1st or from January 1st to December 31st in a particular year. Well, we have over 2.5 million images in the archive of these 60 or so cameras we have out there now. So what do we do with them? Well, like I said, we try to tell stories of showing change over time on a landscape that you wouldn't be able to see before. So one way, using this camera as an example, is here is early summer. Here's late summer. Here's the fall. Here's the winter. Can tile them together to show change over time. But where it really starts to sing is when you put them into time-lapse videos and all of a sudden the earth comes alive and it becomes its own living, breathing thing. Or you can take it and do something like this, where you can take that same frame and you can put 12 consecutive months together from January all the way to December and tile them together in a more artful display. Or you can use another location like the wet meadow at Mormon Island on Crane Trust land. And we can just tile them together in four seasons, blending them together into one motif. Or we can take a number of these time-lapse cameras and we can show you what they look like together all in one year from mountains to plains, as these time lapses unravel everything from crop fields to irrigation networks to wild places. We began to employ graphics onto these cameras and their library of images to help forward science. So in this way, we can actually measure change over time, like the erosion here along this bank at the confluence of the Platte and the Missouri. We have a lot more scientific research that's engaged in our project now. Or we can look at natural events that happen that are significant that we wouldn't be able to capture otherwise, like this. You remember the large floods that we had in Nebraska in late winter 2019 and throughout much of the Central Plains. Well, this captured one of those flooding events. And the only way we were able to get these pictures was because it was connected via cellular network. And it sent us pictures as this ice jam broke until the camera went dark and we lost it to the river. And besides putting time-lapse cameras out, we're putting out camera traps in places, not to get that one picture that we want, but to keep them in place for years at a time so we can see the whole parade of wildlife that move across important pieces of habitat in these landscapes, like across this beaver dam, where of course you're going to record the beaver. But also in this little dam location, you get the possum and the drake and the mink and the otter and the raccoon. And we're putting out video technologies that are staying in place for a long time too, to see things we wouldn't be able to see before, like otters in that same beaver dam complex wrestling in front of the camera and underwater as well, like this otter capturing this giant catfish. And we take those all together and we put them into tiles again and show you the diversity of life that happens. Every one of these cameras that you're going to see here are all within about a quarter mile radius of each other, that if you were driving down the interstate in Nebraska and you looked off in the distance out where these cameras are, you would think that there's nothing out there at all. Well, where does all this stuff live? Well, this all lives on a website called Platte Basin Timelapse, and Platte Basin Timelapse is a partnership with the University of Nebraska Lincoln, and we're now housed in the School of Natural Resources. And a long time ago, when I showed you that picture of Mike and I, when we started this project, we, you know, it was our project, but man, quickly, it became an entire community's effort. And that was the goal. And what we do is we tell stories. We're not scientists, but we are storytellers. And we've told over 140 stories to this point about this big watershed of ours in the heart of the Great Plains. And the strength and the resiliency of this project is in the diversity of voices of this people. And here are some of the people. And as you can see in this, this is very student heavy. We have lots of undergraduate students and graduate students. We also have researchers and other friends that are out in the watershed. We're trying to build community, thinking like a watershed where every voice matters. Last year, this is the same road that I showed you where I was standing in my 3D camo suit, but 20 years later, where my buddy Mike on the left there are with our team of interns that we had last year, taking them to watch cranes on the Platte River. So thinking like a watershed, it doesn't matter if you live where I live in Nebraska or you live somewhere that's halfway around the world. We all live in a watershed, and we all are community in that. And I think that maybe is one of the most important things that I want to get across today. Can leverage photography as a powerful tool to tell a story, but it's what our mindset is, it's what our philosophy is, it's what our perspective is moving forward. And we may be like a braided river where, you know, we are all taking the same channel all the time, but we do, you know, go apart, but come together and go apart and come together and move in the same direction, the way a river is supposed to flow. And if we do that, things are good. So let me end here back on the Platte. You know, it's the Platte Basin Timelapse Project has been going for 10 years. This next year will be our 10th year anniversary. And I've started to look at what one other story is that I could tell. And if it's the only story that I've got left to tell, this is what I want it to be. And it's on whooping cranes. Coming back to the roots of cranes. Back in October of last year on Halloween, I watched these four whooping cranes, three of them a family group, and the other one I think was young from last year, land on the Platte River at the Crane Trust. And at that moment, watching those birds do what they do as elegantly as they do it until, you know, deep into the night, I knew I needed to do work with these birds, and it's sort of a nexus of thinking about cranes across a continent and Great Plains as an ecosystem and the Platte as a watershed. They all bring it together. So I went down and started doing work with researchers and other conservation folks in a geography that was unfamiliar to me. I'd never been to Aransas National Wildlife Refuge or the Gulf Coast of Texas, but that's where I found myself a lot this winter, this last winter. And back in a blind again, you're actually looking at a blind on a roost where we hope to imagine some whooping cranes into being. And this is what it looked like inside the blind. And used that blind for a few days, went into it in the middle of the day and didn't come out until, you know, the next day. But this was one picture that was captured. Again, one of the most remarkable moments that I've ever seen. And I keep finding myself saying remarkable moments I've ever seen every time I talk about cranes, but it's true. So that's the next stage, next chapter of this project, of my project. And I hope I can bring a whole community of people along with me and including you all here with the International Crane Foundation. So I want to end with a little minute and a half video of whooping cranes on the Platte that we actually made for Marjorie Nicholson, who's no longer with us, but was a board member for ICF for a very, very long time. And Marjorie couldn't get out to see cranes on the Platte the last couple of years. But I shared this with her, and I haven't shared it with anybody else. I'd like to share it with you. Thank you, Marjorie. And with that, I will thank all of you at ICF, and I will stop share.
Oh, Mike, thank you for that moment of zen that we all needed. So many folks in the chat are just fanned away by that stunning presentation. So. We had some good questions for you. But first, I wanted to just make a comment about, you know, some of those pictures in that video at the end were wonderful because they were those whooping cranes in a sea of sandhills were one in many. And it really, really tells the story about how the story of the sandhill cranes and the whooping cranes. So you've told the story of the sandhill cranes in North America. And now you're telling the story of the whooping cranes in North America. And I wondered if you mentioned that at the end, that is your project that you're working on now. And I wondered if you had an update on how that is going.
Well, thanks, Ann, and hello, everybody. Yeah, it's madness.
That's our crane world.
Why is it so hard?
Early mornings.
Yeah. The project's going really well, and I've had a tremendous amount of support, and it's we're in our third year on this now, and I think I'm probably about 80% done. I've got the rest of this year with a short list of places to go, and then should be pretty well wrapped up. But yeah, it's every crane in the world has a story to tell, and they're all equally compelling. But you know, in North America we have two crane species: the sandhill crane, the most populous, and the whooping crane, the most rare. And to see them come together in one place at one time on the Platte in your backyard is a really great. Great experience. And fortunately, these days, as whooping crane numbers continue to slowly climb back up, we're starting to not just see one whooping crane out there among sand hills, but, you know, maybe a half a dozen whooping cranes or more. And even last fall, we had historic numbers of whooping cranes on the Platte. We had over 60 in the Platte Valley at one time,
Yeah,
which is more amazing than has been there in over a century. So yeah. There's a lot of good news with these birds.
Yep. Somebody just commented that your use of remarkable, it is, it's remarkable. It's amazing. It's there's not enough words to describe all that you've been able to see. So thank you for sharing that. And then on that note, I want to remind people that we've been posting in the chat, there's a link to the Platte Basin Timelapse project and also to Mike's website. So you can see more about that project, his other work, his books that are fantastic. And all of that is on the chat. So please go there and visit, especially the Platte Basin Timelapse, all of those movies that you've created together are there. So please go and visit that. A couple of short questions that we had that were really interesting that I thought, a friend of the Cranes, Maggie, asked, what kind of fish were those in the that you showed, those little tiny tropical fish of North America?
Yeah, there's a lot of minnows. You know, people think about minnows, they think of minnows as being the baby fish that grow into the big fish, and there's actually species of minnows. So those were rosy-faced shiners, red-bellied daces, common shiners, and maybe a couple stone rollers in there. But they were in these big feeding shoals. So, you know, if any of you have seen salmon spawning in the Pacific Northwest or in other parts of the Western U.S., you know, you could see at a distance when they're all together in shallow water because they color that water a completely different color, oftentimes red, depending on the species. And you get that in the Great Plains too, in these tiny little headwater streams, when all of these colorful fish and breeding plumage come together to feed. And it's really, really, really something. So.
Right. Yeah. Well, and it's just, it takes a village. It, you know, these cranes are what we can see, and they stand in for all those little things that are often unseen, which is what that Platte Basin time lapse is really showing us, all the other things that goes on there. Somebody in the comment box had noted about beavers and how important they are and what great habitat builders they are. I agree. Yeah. So that is fantastic. Somebody had asked about how do you build a blind? And I want to expand on that question for you, Mike, because the blind depends on your situation, of course. And you actually had, after that question was asked, you showed pictures of several other different kinds. So talk a little bit about how you think about designing a blind, how you get into them. Basically, you're just kind of making yourself part of that landscape, whatever the landscape is, north to south, right?
Yep. Yeah, well, a couple questions in there. I think one of the things folks don't think about in a blind is how to get in and get out without being seen. And that's usually the first question that you try to answer. And so there's great places you can go put a blind out, but if you got to walk into it and walk out of it and you're in full view, then that's a problem. So it really is like a puzzle. It's like solving a puzzle, looking at the landscape, watching the animals, and then trying to figure it out. So that takes a lot of time. And yeah, not all blinds fit every situation. So, you know, some blinds are just big enough to lay on your belly. Some can be very spacious and comfortable. You know,
spacious and comfortable is a relative term, audience.
Well, you have to be comfortable being uncomfortable maybe, but yeah, you know, I'm not cheap. I'm frugal. I prefer to say I'm frugal. So for $20 or maybe 30 now with inflation, you can go down to your local hardware store and you can buy a roll of 25-foot garden fence, zip ties, and some duct tape, and you can make yourself blinds, which is what I do a lot of times. And I try to use the materials that are in the area of the animals that I'm trying to photograph.
Right.
And these blinds can be shaped the way that you want them to, with no hard edges. And nobody's going to steal them because they don't cost very much and they don't look like anything. You know, and who would go lay in one anyway?
Yep, an 8-year-old child.
If
they have any sense.
Which is what I qualify for, if you ask my family and friends probably. So it's the blinds are an important tool, and you know, a blind can be your car, a blind can be the window in your bedroom, you know, looking out over something. And I think a lot of folks think that when we use blinds that the animals don't know that we're there. I think they know you're there. I just think think they've accepted you, that you've you're in there, but you're not a threat. So if you get in and get out unseen, and you honor the animal, and you go ahead and you stay that extra hour until it's dark to move out, or you stay that extra day or whatever, then it's right. Then it's all good. So
I just happened to see somebody had posted another follow-up to that, you know, they happen to have panic attacks of claustrophobia. Do you feel more comfortable in that blind? I mean, it's very enclosed. Do you want to be small? You know, does that ever occur to you to be that you're thinking that you're in an enclosed space, or are you part of the bigger environment?
No, you know, like I don't like elevators because or caves. I mean, I like caves, but you know, other people can go caving. So I sort of have that issue too, but in blinds, no, it's not a big deal. And, you know, it's a completely different experience. I just feel like it's being really intimate with the land.
Right.
So, and you can, you know, the great thing about blinds is it's not just, you're not just seeing something, but all of your senses are at work. So you don't just see, but you sometimes photograph with your ears, you know, you hear things happening before you see them, or you know, the wind comes through and there's a scent of an elk or there's something else. It's a great thing to do, is to spend deep time in a place and not move at all. And then when it is boring, you know, you figure out how many times you can split a blade of grass in two, you know, or count the ants, you know. So it's one of those serenity now times.
I bet it is. Wendy asked an interesting question, and I'm going to take liberties, Wendy, and paraphrase this for you, where I think you were meaning. She had asked about you spending time in the Northwest Territories, and she wondered how you found the conditions there. And I'm wondering if you meant like there's a lot of fires going through there, and you know, of course, there's not too far from there. There it's tar sands, and you know, did you spend time there and have any thoughts on what the habitat is like up towards Wood Buffalo National Park, where the whooping cranes are breeding?
Sure. So I spent a little bit of time there, and I'm going back in a couple of weeks. So the little bit of time that I spent was for part of this whooping crane project is we followed what I call the Whooper Highway, which is the Aransas to Wood Buffalo flock, whooping cranes, which numbers about 500. Two friends of mine and I followed their migratory pathway north this spring from the Texas Gulf Coast to Wood Buffalo National Park. My buddy Jeff drove and was a support vehicle, and my buddy Chris was my pilot, and we flew in Chris's sassy little 1953 red plane and flew right up the heart of the continent. And our endpoint was Wood Buffalo National Park. And so it was a remarkable experience. And when you get up into Wood Buffalo, you know, Wood Buffalo is the third largest national park in the world, I believe. It's somewhere around the lines of 25 million acres. And you know, the wilderness doesn't stop at the park boundary. So it's a remarkable place. Its scale is unimaginable. And I only touched it just a bit. I was going to be up there for a couple weeks in nesting season for whooping cranes, but at the last minute had to cancel that trip because of unprecedented high waters up there from a very wet winter. But we may try that again next year. And when I go back in a couple of weeks, I'm going to be with biologists that are doing whooping crane surveys, and also a capture crew that is going to be capturing and affixing some telemetry onto some of the juvenile birds that nested this year. So, so more to come on that, but I can't wait to get back up there. Come here, Bettis.
Hi, I apologize for my yellow lab, Bettis. He's a friend of the crane too.
He is.
So Mike, I have a question for you. I have heard you talk about Nebraska and your love of Nebraska, and you're a native Nebraskan. And actually there's quite a few people that commented on how they now have new and much, much greater appreciation for Nebraska. Thank you.
Wonderful. Excellent.
So you have a sense of home and place. What, have you ever wanted to go overseas to go other places, or do you prefer to stay closer to home?
I'd love to go overseas, but it just hasn't worked out yet for me, and there's plenty at home, you know. So Bettis, come here. I'd like to take Bettis overseas with me, and we could go through the Mongolian steppe or the veld in South Africa. I think he wants out, Anne.
You can let him out. Open that door.
Stand by, folks.
He's a good boy. Speaking of that, the more places you go, the more things stay the same. Please visit www.savingcranes.org for more information on our projects in all of those areas. Please do. Yeah. All right. Bettis is taken care of. You were mentioning the Mongolian steppe, where we have a project with white-necked cranes there. It's very similar, probably, to the Great Plains that we have here.
Yeah, I would love to see where all of these crane species live, you know. When I worked on the Sandhill Crane book, which is now almost 20 years ago, it got me out of the country for the first and last time, I think. And I'm not counting Canada. No offense to Canada, but I was able to go to Cuba. And Cuba, there's a one of the three non-migratory subspecies of sandhill cranes is the Cuban sandhill crane, and you know, what an exotic experience there. And you know, these cranes can just in Cuba they're in palm savannas, and they oftentimes don't roost in water, and they nest on upland sites, and they're very different in a lot of ways. And so I look forward, hopefully, when I get a little bit older, that I can have some opportunities to go see these birds in some other places. So and to me, at this point, it'd be grand to photograph them. But at this point in my life, it'd just be nice to see them.
Yeah, you know? To sit back and actually enjoy them. Yeah.
No blinds.
We do have a technical question for you, sort of. Yeah. How has your technology changed over the past 10 years? Some things have changed and some things haven't.
Yeah. You know, I mean, we always chase technology. So as a photographer, you're always looking for the best, newest camera with the largest megapixels that can see in the dark and can take, you know, 50 frames a second and all of that stuff. So you're chasing technology. And you can be a slave to that, or you can try to understand that still maybe the best tool that you have of all is what's here in your head and what's in your heart. You know, it's not as much to go get those pictures as it is what is it that you're trying to say. And so, you know, you have to, you know, like anyone, you have to understand how your tools work. And you have to be adept at them. It's like a musician is a good analogy, you know, or somebody that's an athlete, where you don't want to think about the 29 steps of your golf swing, and you don't want to think about how to play each of those notes on the piano. You want to be able to have that be so second nature to you that you just put that behind you so that you can just create and feel. And you can do that with a phone. You know, or you can do that with $30,000 worth of equipment. But, you know, it's.
You just need to get out there and do. Is that the final word?
You got to be out there. Yeah, you got to be out there. So
thank you so much, Mike. We're going to wrap up here. But it was wonderful, wonderful to get the update on this project. And, you know, look forward to figuring out how this all wraps up. So stay tuned, folks. For the wrap up of that project in a year or so. So thank you so much to our webinar sponsors again today. It was wonderful of you to do that. Look on your news feed and our savingcranes.org for the next webinar coming in August. I'll be doing one in September, so stay tuned for that. Thank you everyone for being here and enjoying. It was great to have you. Be well.